Assalamualaikum class. So let's continue our discussion on bioenergetics and oxidative phosphorylation. In this lecture, we will be studying about ATP, how and why this ATP is called the energy currency of the cell, what are the biological oxidation reduction reactions, and then we will continue our discussion regarding the paths of electron in metabolism and how this flow of electron does the biological work and what is a biological circuit. Adenosine triphosphate or ATP. ATP is the chemical link between catabolism and anabolism. It is the energy currency of a living cell. The hexagonic conversion of ATP to adenosine diphosphate and inorganic phosphate, or its conversion into adenosine monophosphate and production of a pyrophosphate molecule, is coupled to many endergonic reactions and processes. Direct hydrolysis of ATP is the source of energy in the conformational changes that produce muscle contraction. But in general, it is not ATP hydrolysis, but the transfer of a phosphoryl or pyrophosphoryl or an adenyl group from ATP to a substrate or enzyme molecule. That transfer couples the energy of the ATP breakdown to endergonic transformation of the substrate. Through these group transfer reactions, ATP provides the energy for anabolic reactions, including the synthesis of informational molecule, and also for the transport of molecules and ions across the plasma membrane against concentration gradient and electric potential gradient. Besides ATP, cells also contain other metabolites with large negative free energy of hydrolysis. We have some examples such as a phosphoenol pyruvate, bisphosphoglycerate, and phosphocreatinine. These three high energy compounds, like ATP, have a high phosphoryl group transfer potential. They are good donors of the phosphoryl group. Thioesters also have a high free energy of hydrolysis. Inorganic polyphosphate, which is present within the cell, may also serve, well, it actually serves as a reservoir of phosphoryl groups with a high group transfer potential. Biological oxidation reduction reactions. The transfer of phosphoryl group is a central feature of metabolism. Equally important is another kind of transfer, electrons transfer in oxidation reduction reactions. So first, just quickly revise what is oxidation and what is reduction. Oxidation in simple terms is the gain of oxygen, while reduction is the loss of oxygen. If we talk about the same oxidation reduction reactions in terms of movement of electron, oxidation is the loss of electron and reduction is the gain of electron. Now, this electron transfer reaction involves the loss of electron by one chemical species, which is thereby oxidized, and the gain of electron by another species, which is as a result reduced. The flow of electrons in oxidation reduction reaction is responsible directly or indirectly for all the work done by the living organism. In non-photosynthetic organism, the source of electrons are reduced compounds, which are actually the foods that we eat. While in the case of photosynthetic organism, the initial electron donor is a chemical species excited by the absorption of the light. The path the electrons follow in metabolism is complex. Electrons move from various metabolic intermediates to specialized electron carriers in enzyme-catalyzed reactions. The carriers in turn donate electrons to acceptor with higher electron affinity, and therefore they release energy. Cells contain a variety of molecular energy transducers which convert the energy of electron flow into useful work. In other parts of bioenergetic series of the lecture, we will study the description of the general types of metabolic reactions in which electrons are transferred. And after considering the theoretical and experimental basis for measuring the energy changes in oxidation reduction reaction in terms of electromotive force, we will also discuss the relationship between the force expressed in volts and the free energy change, which is expressed in joules. Now, the flow of electrons within the biological systems or within the cell can do a lot of biological work. I can explain this with the help of a simple example. Like every time when we use a motor or an electric light or a heater, or when we turn our or we turn on our car, or like we spark to ignite the gasoline in the car engine, we use the flow of electron to do this work. For example, I have a circuit on the left side of this slide. In this circuit, you can see that the power is power that is provided to a motor, for example. The source of electron in this case can be a battery, like you can see here. It contains two chemical species that differ in affinity for electron. The electrical wires, you see, they provide a pathway for the flow of electron from the chemical species at one pole to the other pole of the battery. And then they are also going to move through the motor if it is connected to them. Now, the chemical species at the other pole of the battery, they have different affinity for the electron. Because the two chemical species differ in their affinity for the electrons are going to flow spontaneously through the circuit, driven by the force proportional to the differences in electron affinity. This force is called the electromotive force. Now, this electromotive force, which is typically a few volt, can accomplish work if in an appropriate energy transducer, for example, a motor is connected to it or is placed within the circuit. Now, this motor can be coupled to a variety of mechanical devices to do a lot of useful work. Similarly, in living cells, they have a kind of biological circuit with a relatively reduced compound such as glucose as a source of electron. Now, when a glucose molecule is enzymatically oxidized, they are going to release electrons. These electrons flow spontaneously through a series of electron carrier intermediates to another chemical species, for example, we can say oxygen. The electron flow is exergonic because oxygen has a higher affinity for electron than to the electron carrier intermediates. The resulting electromotive force generated, therefore, would provide energy to a variety of molecular transducers, for example, enzymes or other proteins, and then they are going to do a lot of biological work. For example, in the case of a mitochondria, membrane-bound enzyme couple electron flow to the production of a transmembrane pH difference, which leads to osmotic and electrical work. The proton gradient thus formed has potential energy, sometimes called the proton motive force. And this proton motive force is similar to the electromotive force. Another enzyme, for example, ATP synthase in the inner mitochondrial membrane uses the proton motive force to do chemical energy, chemical work such as the synthesis of ATP from ADP and inorganic phosphates as proton continue to flow spontaneously across the membrane. Similarly, membrane localized enzymes in microbes such as E. coli convert this electron motive force to proton motive force, which is then used to do different types of activities, such as it also provides the power to the flagella for the movement of the microbe. Many biological oxidation reduction reactions are dehydrogenation reactions, in which one or two hydrogen atoms are transferred from a substrate to a hydrogen acceptor. Now, these oxidation reduction reactions in living cells involve specialized electron carriers. Here comes the most amazing biological molecules, NAD, FAD, and FMN. FAD, or flavinadenine dinucleotide, is a redox cofactor that is created during the Krebs cycle and utilized during the last part of respiration, which is the electron transport chain. While NAD or NADH or nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide is a similar compound used more actively in the electron transport chain as well. In fact, we can say that NADH is produced and used than FADH in the process of creating energy. This is actually, we can say that there are almost 6 NADH molecules produced and only 2 FADH molecules are produced. Now, these two compounds are used to move electrons in the electron transport chain. NAD and NADPH are freely diffusible coenzymes of many dehydrogenases, while FAD and FMN, which are the flavonucleotides, serve as a tightly bound prosthetic groups of flavoproteins, and they can accept either one or two electrons. Now let's talk about oxidative phosphorylation. oxidative phosphorylation is commonly called the electron transport chain. Let's just start it from the scratch. We all know that glucose undergoes glycolysis to become pyruvate. This pyruvate and turns back to glucose by the process of gluconeogenesis. The pyruvate can take one of many routes of the metabolic pathway, but the most common destination for pyruvate is to turn back into acetyl-CoA. This acetyl-CoA then enters the Krebs cycle or the TCA cycle to generate NADH and FAD2 molecules, as I told you earlier. These NADH and FADH2 are incredibly important byproducts, and they are used in a set of redox reactions that transfer electrons in the oxidative phosphorylation or electron transport chain to generate massive amounts of ATP. First of all, let's talk about glycolysis. Cell derives energy from the nutrients such as glucose, you all know that. The oxidation of glucose to pyruvate occurs through a series of reactions called glycolysis, as you can see here, the one which is represented by the red lines. The energy released during these oxidation reduction reaction is used to synthesize ATP molecule, which is the energy currency of the cell. The first step in the hydrolysis of glucose is the addition of 2-phosphate to the glucose molecule at the expense of 2 ATP molecules. First, ATP is used up when glucose changes to glucose-6-phosphate. This glucose-6-phosphate then isomerizes to form fructose-6-phosphate. A second ATP molecule is consumed and fructose-6-phosphate changes to fructose-1,6-bisphosphate. This 6-carbon sugar is a diphosphate molecule, and then it splits into 2 3-carbon sugar molecules. One is dihydroxyacetone phosphate and the other one is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And these two are interchangeable with the help of an isomerase enzyme. Now, acted upon by the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, this glyceraldehyde changes into 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Now, during this reaction, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized while a NAD molecule, as you can see here, is reduced to NADH and a proton is also released. 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate then donates one of its phosphate to an ADP molecule, generating an ATP molecule, and it turns into a 3-phosphoglycerate molecule. This 3-phosphoglycerate isomerizes by the help of an enzyme isomerase to 2-phosphoglycerate, which then loses a water molecule and becomes phosphoenol pyruvate. This phosphoenol pyruvate generated is quite unstable and it immediately loses its phosphate group in the final step of glycolysis, forming another ATP molecule, and then it turns into the final product, pyruvate. Now, this is the net reaction of glycolysis. You can see that at the end of glycolysis, we are left with 2 ATP molecules, 2 NADH, and 2 pyruvate molecule. Now, if oxygen is available, this pyruvate can be broken down or oxidized all the way to carbon dioxide in cellular respiration, making a lot of ATP molecule. Otherwise, the process of fermentation will take place and we will have end product, lactate or lactic acid. Now, what happens to the NADH molecules? It can't just sit around in the cell piling up. That's because cells have only a certain number of NAD and NADH molecules which cycle back and forth between oxidized and reduced states. Now, you all know that glycolysis needs NAD to accept electron as a part of a specific reaction that we studied previously. If there is no NAD molecule around because it's all stuck up in the form of NADH, this reaction cannot take place and the process of glycolysis will come to a halt. So all the cells need is a way to turn NADH back to NAD to keep glycolysis going. Now, there are 2 basic ways of doing this. When oxygen is present, NADH can pass its electron into the electron transport chain, regenerating it for use in glycolysis. and when oxygen is absent, cells may use other simpler pathways to regenerate NAD ions. In these pathways, NADH donates its electron to an acceptor molecule in a reaction that does not make ATP, but it generates NAD molecule. So glycolysis can continue, and this process is also called as fermentation.